sometimes you don't know where it's going. So that's all the sound sources on this table. Basically, on this table, I've got each of the synthesizers going through at least one time delay thing. These are a combination of delays and reverbs, just to give it a little bit more of a spacious sound. And so, like on this guy, let's see, if, where am I set up here? The one that's set up with this one, here's what it sounds like by itself. Oh, when I first got this thing, there was this sound that always went. Filter frequency down to a certain level, or it just makes this drone. And I was like, oh, I can live with this. I'm like, I gotta figure out what this is. But here's what the synthesizer sounds like with nothing else. Sounds like, I don't know, like very early 70s, it has sort of this, I don't know, this kind of romantic kind of tints to it already. So I'm using this delay that is supposed to simulate an old tape delay, because I think it enhances the flavor it already has. Seems like a very sentimental robot. So that's why I put it with this one. And then the other synth I do the exact opposite. This one seems like it wants to go dancing. So I'll play what that synth sounds like already. This has this interesting hold function, and when you get it the first time, you can just put your fingers down. And wants to start a pattern for you right away. I found this really nice percussive delay. So there's the original pattern. And then with the delay on. See how it's like kind of skipping on itself? Sometimes it sounds like it's like tripping on itself. So that's what those are set up for. And then the last thing that I started doing recently is I started doing this technique where I'm running a big delay out of the sends on this mixer, and basically it means that any instrument, depending on how you set these green knobs, basically go to these two kind of idiosyncratic delays. So this is like reggae producers like King Tubby used to do this, where they would take one single sound. Let's see if I can do this. So that's the sound that's going right into the that's what's going into the mixer. But then sometimes I will take that sound and run it into here. Or if I want to make a little collage, I'll turn this little looper pedal. I know you guys have seen a lot of people. They play live, they play like one rhythm pass and they lock it down. So what I can do with this one is, so now it's being recorded locked into here along with like the leftovers of whatever thing that's still in memory. And this is fun because you can flip this around and make it go backwards and go slower. But this is something that I love doing, and just like having a like an ongoing conversation with this thing. If you ever see something that's going on and like it doesn't look like any of the synths are running, it could be that like all the leftovers are in here. So I'll do one more improvisation based off this book. The one thing that's really interesting is there's so much joy and collaboration, these two characters doing things together. And then I won't give away too much, but you know, it gets to a part of the book where they're not feeling the same they're not getting the same enjoyment of these things that kept them going when they were kids. So I will try and do something a little different on this one. Okay. Right now I'm gonna go through this and I'm gonna start again from scratch. So I'm going to all these tracks and just cleaning out the banks. And I'm gonna go in the opposite direction. Thank you. not just like, all this junk on the table. Maxwell?
How long did it take to put all of this together?
You mean just today?
No, how long did it take to like collect all the cords and...
Probably a couple of years.
It's a
long time. Maxwell, what book are you reading right now?
I'm not really sure.
Any other questions?
So how long did it take you to put all this together today?
I started at 1, and then at some point I thought I broke the amplifier, and then I went through a little panic spiral. But you know, the one thing that this brings up is like, I'm still trying to figure out, because like, obviously there's so many pieces of equipment that I'm still trying to figure out what the best layout is. And this is sort of what it's come to be over the last couple performances. And I started to realize like I have to figure out, as a right-handed person who can't play very good piano, of like, I what do I have to do here and how can I get over here? So it's like all the little things have been shifting around. I've been writing little diagrams where the little boxes move around. So still trying to figure that out.
How does this influence the other music you do and vice versa?
I don't know yet. Because it's the thing that I've noticed is like I always like to write a couple themes before I get going. But then it's like there's a lot of X factor as the machines start talking to each other. So I notice that many times I'll abandon like a plan I had very quickly and just improvise for a bit and then try and bring back a theme later. But it's the way that you compose just at a piano or a guitar or something is only like one like chunk of what happens when you hear all the textures. And sometimes when you're in a room and the sounds are bouncing around, and there's a certain combination of sounds that are now being echoed in the electronics that you didn't really anticipate. Sometimes I notice that like I'm playing the theme a lot slower, a lot faster than I did the time before. Any other questions over here?
Where do you get your synth sounds from?
The sounds themselves?
Yeah.
You know, what I'm really trying to do is like, I'm still trying to learn all this stuff. But what I'm trying to do is like, I've noticed that every piece of gear has like one thing that it speaks to you and you just respond to it. And then you just set up the other things for contrasting tones. But it's pretty much, you know, I think nowadays when people buy like a piano or a synthesizer, they try and get the unit with 8,000 things that they can play with. And I've noticed that I've done the complete opposite. I just expect 1.5 sounds from this big box. And this does one great thing. And this does one thing. And then I just noticed that and I think this goes back to Maxwell's question, is like, when I realized this did one thing, this is like the first nice one I got. And I think I was trying to make it do everything. And then when I made it do 1.5 things, and I got this, I realized they could have a nice conversation. If they all do the same thing, or they don't have specified jobs, it's kind of total chaos. Everyone's trying to do the same thing. But when everyone has like one job, they can support each other. Like, you know, like a string quartet or a small orchestra. But sometimes, you know, I always go through this spiel at Old Town School of like, when you buy any musical instrument, try not to do too much research, because these are just other people's opinions. All these things were like a piece of equipment that when I started playing, I wanted to play for 8 hours. And if you have a piece of equipment, then you're like, I could probably learn to like this, just pass it up, you know? But I think it's just like, this does like a certain set of like really nice legato sounds, and I tend to make this guy slightly more percussive. So if I go with that, then they sort of find their way around each other. Having a bunch of things that are general purpose doesn't really do anything. I mean, I guess we all have like that thing from Trader Joe's, a sauce that does 5,000 things fairly well, you know? But that's the kind of thing that ends up in the back of the refrigerator.
Do you have any inspirations from any certain video game composers or video game soundtracks?
You know, the thing about like video game composers, at least the ones that I know of, like the old school ones, the one thing that I'm always surprised at is everything is voice. And it's just like how primitive the vocabulary was. I mean, let's see if I can turn. You notice like these are still labeled, and I'm like, what is it? 1, 2, 3, 4. Like this is just, if I just turn off the oscillators or things that actually make the notes and just add sounds. I used to do a little work with a company that did like commercials and things, and the thing that was always challenging is that we'd like you to write something in 7 seconds or sometimes 2 seconds. And then the one thing I've noticed is like you've really got to, for certain things, just know how to compose sound in the quickest possible way. So the thing that has been, I don't know if I'm answering your question or not, the thing that is so weird is like talking about sounds in terms of filters and attack and decay and like combining sounds is really weird compared to like doing traditional.
On this more out of like the simple joy of like your curiosity around the instruments, or is it more because of like commercial work or things that?
Oh no, I think it's just like trying to be like an 11-year-old, like being inside like a bad science fiction film from the mid-80s. I mean, really that's what it is. It's like also like my main instrument is technically the guitar. But I feel like this has been such an interesting thing to do, especially like during like COVID lockdown, of just like building up sounds by yourself. So.
Do you ever, or like, do you mainly do improvisation on here? Like, you never like write things that you play again on it?
You know, there are certain themes I've been playing the whole time through.
Yeah.
But then I've noticed that every day I play it, I kind of tweak it melodically a bit. So there are definitely like, you know, like elements that keep coming back, but they're always stretched out.
Hi, Charles. I was curious, as you composed, is it like more of a feeling, like jazz, where it takes you down a path and then you kind of bring it back, or?
You know, the thing that was really interesting when you read the book is just, I think the thing is, at least when you're supporting a pre-existing artistic work, is like make all your instincts secondary to like the big themes, mm-hmm. You know. And then I notice that when I get here and I'm in the room with everyone, like there's a lot of real world instincts that change. Mm-hmm. So at least with this project, with the public library, I've been trying to start with that and then allow myself to just open up when I get
some structure.
Thank you so much for coming. I hope you guys.